No. Amen. Amen. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we just come this morning thanking you for this glorious morning, Lord. We rejoice in your rising up. We rejoice in the fact that you are a risen King, a risen Savior. And now, Lord, touch my mouth that I may speak boldly what you have given me to speak. That it may accomplish what you have had to do. That I may make known the mysteries of the gospel. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
What would you do?
What would you do?
You have 1 week left.
Uh-oh.
And then you die.
Oh, Lord.
What would you do in that week? Would you go out and get a lot of stuff you wouldn't normally get because you won't have to pay for it? Would you go around telling people off you had an issue with for years?
No.
Would you commit crimes?
No.
Would you quit your job?
No.
Or would you help people?
Well.
Would you try to get things right with God?
Amen.
You have 1 week left on earth and you know it. What would you do?
What would you do?
Last week I told you that Jesus made his triumphal entry into Jerusalem.
Uh-huh.
He came in riding on a borrowed donkey.
Yeah.
And the people shouted, "Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord." Hosanna in the highest.
Yes.
They put their cloaks down and they took palm branches off the trees to lay in the path for him. With their shouts of Hosanna to the son of David, they were proclaiming him king. But Jesus knew his assignment. He knew his time was short and he knew what was about to happen.
Mm-hmm.
And here's what Jesus did. We used to sing a song, "Let Us Have a Little Talk with Jesus."
Yes, yes.
But this morning we're going to take a little walk with Jesus.
Right.
We're going to begin where we left off last week in Matthew 21, and we're going to start with verse 12.
All
right. You're going to have to just keep your Bibles open because we're taking a walk. Amen?
Amen?
So there's a lot of scriptures that we're going to be going through. But he began his week with the triumphal entry into Jerusalem, and in verse 12, he goes to his place, the temple, for worship. But when he gets there, he finds all these merchants in the outer court selling things, like doves, to the people who had traveled in for the celebration and had to have sacrifices. This was the outer courts where the Gentiles should have been worshiping, yet it had become a marketplace for the crooked money changers, and Jesus wasn't having it, telling them, "It is written, 'My house shall be called the house of prayer,' but ye have made it a den of thieves."
Uh-huh.
Sometimes when you know your time is short, you want to do some housekeeping. You may start to get things in order so there won't be a burden on those you leave behind. And now that Jesus has cleansed the temple, the blind and lame are coming, and he heals them. Jesus is working right up to the day of his departure.
Amen.
You see, just because your time is short,
what?
It doesn't mean you just stop working. It doesn't mean you just stop doing what it is you were called, hired, or appointed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it was this spirit of obedience the chief priests and scribes didn't like. It was the spirit of compassion that drew the people to him. And it was the spirit of dedication that made the scribes and Pharisees and the leaders want to take his life. They didn't like the way people responded to him. Sometimes it doesn't matter what you do. There will still be people who are not going to like you.
Amen.
But stay on task.
Amen.
Don't turn to the left.
Amen.
Or to the right.
That's for me.
You keep your eyes on Jesus.
That's for me.
Amen. Amen. Jesus was on his way to Bethany and he cursed a fig tree that was not doing what it was created to do. It bore no fruit.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yes, it had leaves. It looked like a fig tree.
Mm-hmm.
And today we see people who look like Christians.
What?
But here's the thing, are you bearing any fruit? It's not enough to just look like a Christian, talk like a Christian, shout like a Christian, dance like a Christian. True Christians bear fruit.
Come on now.
A true Christian tells others about the goodness of the Lord.
Amen.
A true Christian was made to make God's praise glorious.
Yes.
A true Christian was created to worship the Lord, and a true Christian was commanded to go ye therefore and make disciples.
That's right.
Jesus continued to teach,
mm-hmm.
using parables, stories that people would understand. He He continued to challenge the chief priests and the Pharisees. He told of the king who had prepared a wedding feast for his son, and when the invited guests failed to come, he invited whosoever will.
Come on now.
That's you. That's me.
That's right.
We're the whosoever will.
Yeah.
The gospel and salvation is the special feast, and we're the whosoever will, invited to partake of it.
Yes.
Put on your garment of praise and have a seat at the table. You're hereby special invitation.
Amen.
As Jesus continues his journey, the more he does, the more uneasy the leaders become. They begin their plot to kill him.
Yeah.
They begin trying to trip him up, trying to get him to say something contrary to the law. You see, Jesus didn't come to destroy the law. He came to fulfill the law.
That's right.
For us, the law was death because there was no way we could keep it. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Diana Perkins saying, we fall down, but we get up. Yeah. If you fall seven times, get up eight, and guess what? You'll find yourself standing. In his last week, Jesus continued to teach. He continued to heal. He continued to perform miracles.
That's right.
He continued to show the Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes, and leaders their hypocritical and deceitful behavior. He showed them their selfish motives. He continued to prepare the disciples for his departure.
Yeah.
He continued to teach about the resurrection and his return. Jesus continued to do what he had always done.
Come on now.
Here's the point. If you knew when your last day on earth was going to be, what you do during your last week, if it's getting your life together, making sure your salvation is sure, taking care of your family, mending broken relationships, getting your house in order, if that's what you would do, then it's what you should be doing right now.
Come on now.
What you would do in your last week should be a continuation of the life you live now.
Yes.
It should be what you've always done. You shouldn't have to do anything different. Live every day like it's your last.
Uh-huh.
Live every week like it's your last week on earth, because we don't know the day nor the hour.
That's right.
That we're going home or that Jesus is soon to return. So here's the question. What are you doing now?
Uh-oh.
Who are you teaching?
What
legacy are you building for future generations?
Amen.
What inheritance are you leaving for those coming behind you? In Matthew chapters 23, 24, and 25, Jesus is teaching the people, calling out leaders, preparing the disciples, and letting us know of things to come. For those of you with the Bibles that have the words of Christ in red, these chapters are, for the most part, all red. You want to know who Jesus was? You want to know what he did? You want to know how he thinks? Read his words, literally.
Yes.
You can learn a lot about a person just by what they say.
Amen.
And then in our walk with Jesus, we find out one of his inner circle, one of his boys, is plotting to betray him.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus chose 12, and one of them betrayed him, and he was God.
Yeah, yeah.
So don't get messed up when someone close to you betrays you.
That's right.
This was not the testimony of all the people, though.
That's right.
Not everyone wanted to kill him. Not everyone was going to betray him. You see, there was a woman. She knew what Jesus had done for her.
Amen.
She knew what he had meant to her in her life.
Yeah.
And not only did she know, she appreciated what he had done, and she showed her appreciation in a tangible way.
That's right.
She wanted to do more than just say a mere thank you. This woman came in with her alabaster box filled with very precious ointment. That means it was expensive.
Yeah, yeah.
And she poured it on his head.
Yeah.
No, his boys didn't understand what she was doing or why, but Jesus knew. And he said she would be remembered for what she had done. That it would be a memorial for her.
Yes.
Not only did she pour the oil on his head, she washed his feet with her tears and dried them with her hair.
Yes.
Ladies, our hair, that's our crown. And she used her crown to dry the feet of Jesus.
Amen.
When you're doing something for the Lord, not everyone will understand.
Mm-hmm.
Not everyone will agree. And not everyone will applaud what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're working for God and your motives are pure,
mm-hmm.
then you serve the Lord with gladness.
Yes.
And know he will count it as a memorial for you.
Amen.
Because while she was showing her appreciation to Jesus for what he had done for her, one of his 12 was selling him out for 30 pieces of silver. And finally, Jesus is preparing for his last meal with the disciples. And he gives them instructions for its preparation. And while there, Jesus calls Judas out for the betrayal he knew he had plotted. They had their meal. They sang a song and left to go to the Mount of Olives. But the betrayal didn't end with Judas selling Jesus out. Peter, his boy, one of his inner circle. We have our circle, and then we have our smaller circle, and then we have our inner circle, those that are closest to us. Peter, that was one of his boys. He took Peter to the Mount of Transfiguration. Peter would deny even knowing Jesus when it got too intense.
That's right.
Jesus is now hours from his ultimate assignment. But before he goes, he needs to pray.
Yes.
Now pay attention. Jesus, the Son of God, God in the flesh, went to the garden to pray and talk to his Father. Now, if Jesus were facing the worst thing he would ever face, separation from his Father, the pain and agony of the cross, if he went to pray, what does that tell you about what we need to be doing?
Come on, man.
Amen.
Church,
amen.
When it gets tough, pray.
Yes.
When you don't know what to do, pray. When you don't know what to say, pray. When you don't know which way to go, pray. When you're choosing a mate, pray. When you're trying to get a job, pray. When you're going to start a career, pray. When you're buying a car, pray. When you're getting ready to buy a house, pray. Jesus prayed. And he was our perfect example.
Yes.
But in that prayer, he said some very important words we need to remember and repeat often. Father, nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done.
Yes.
It's not about us. It's about the will of the Father. God has the perfect plan for each and every one of our lives.
Yes.
The question is, do you trust him to know what's best for you? We're at the final hours now, and if you think what Jesus has endured up to now is something, you ain't seen nothing yet. The soldiers came to get Jesus. Judas betrayed him with a kiss, and even then, Jesus still referred to Judas as a friend. That's in 26:50, Matthew 26:50. Peter cuts off the soldier's ear. Jesus puts it back on. All the disciples make a break. Peter is following from a distance, watching. They found some people to bear false witness against Jesus. In other words, they found some folks to lie. They accused him of blasphemy because he dared to speak the truth about who he was. They began the beating, spitting in his face, slapping him, plucking out his beard. And while all this is happening, Peter is outside denying that he even knows Jesus. Not once, not twice, but three times. And then he started cursing at the people. And after the third time, the rooster crowed immediately as Jesus said it would happen. Meanwhile, the chief priests have now taken Jesus to Pilate, the governor, because the council had decided to put him to death. Judas is now so overcome with guilt and shame, he tries to give the money back, but they refuse to take it. He drops the money in the temple and goes and hangs himself. The money is so tainted they can't even put it in the offering plate at the church. Now here's a lesson for the church. Not all money is good money.
Come on now.
It doesn't need to find its way into the church treasury. Some money you got to turn away. The leaders took the blood money they had given Judas, bought a field with it, and buried Judas in the field when he killed himself. The governor questions Jesus, who refuses to answer except to say, "Thou sayest." In response to the question, "Art thou the king of the Jews?" Now the plot thickens. When given the opportunity to release Jesus, those same people who just 5 days prior were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David," are now screaming, "Crucify him!" My, how people can change. But the beating wasn't over. Now they scourged him. That means they whipped him with a cat of nine tails, which had barbs on the end, and every time they struck his back, he would tear flesh away from his back. They stripped him down. They put a scarlet robe on him. They put a crown of thorns on his head, a reed in his right hand, and mocked him, bowing and saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." Little did they know how right they were. They spit on him some more. They took the reed they had given him and hit him in the head with it. They took off the robe, put on his own clothes back, put his own clothes back on, those clothes that were bloody and tattered and torn. They put those back on to be crucified in. Are you still walking with me? Remember, we're taking a walk with Jesus in his last days here on earth before his crucifixion. And now here we are, it's crucifixion day. Jesus was so weak from the beating he had taken all night long, he couldn't carry the cross, and Simon from Cyrene, which was in North Africa, carried it for him. Sometimes you gotta have a friend. Sometimes you need a little help. Sometimes you gotta have somebody else to carry your cross. Sometimes you need a good friend that'll be willing to carry that cross for you for just a little while until you can make it, until you can get back on your feet. Sometimes you need just a little help. Don't be ashamed. It's no shame in asking for help. Even Jesus needed help, and he was God. When they got to Golgotha, the place of the skull, they gave him vinegar mixed with gall, which was basically a drugged wine that was like anesthetic given to condemned prisoners. But Jesus refused. They proceeded to strip him naked, gamble over his clothes, and nail him to the cross. They nailed his hands. This was no ordinary nail. It was a spike that went through the wrist, tearing through the tendons and the nerves and the bone. They nailed the other hand. They nailed his feet, and then they lifted him up, but wait, if they had left him on the ground, perhaps, just perhaps, they might have been okay, because John 12:32 says this, Jesus said, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all men unto me. They lifted him up.
Amen.
There was a thief to his right and a thief to his left. The people challenged him to come down off the cross and save himself, but he wouldn't do it. You see, Jesus knew his assignment.
Amen.
He knew what had to be done, and he knew he wasn't yet finished. And so he stayed. And so he hung on that cross. And so he endured the pain for you. And so he endured the pain for me.
Yes.
And he stayed on that cross until the sun refused to shine.
Yes.
And so he stayed on that cross until our sin debt was paid in full. There's nothing that you can do. There's nothing that you have done that hadn't already been paid for on the cross. He stayed there until it was finished. The chief priests and the elders mocked him. When it was unbearable, Jesus cried out to his Father, exclaiming, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? You see, Jesus was fully human. He felt every single thing they did to him, and he took it.
Yes.
And then the debt was paid once and for all. He gave up the ghost and died.
Yes, Lord.
They put him in a borrowed tomb. He wouldn't need it for long. Hell thought they had the victory, and the party began. Jesus was in the grave all night Friday night. Satan thought he had won. Jesus was in the grave all day Saturday. Hell said, we got him now. He stayed in the grave all night Saturday night, and the party turned up. Hell saying, it's over now. We got the world in our hands now. Oh, but Sunday was coming. And when it did, hell began to rumble. Jesus was gathering his people, and on Sunday morning, Jesus busted out, taking the keys to death, hell, and the grave. He conquered death, and now we have the opportunity for eternal life. He conquered sin, and now we have the chance to receive forgiveness. He paid it all once and for all. Now we can live again. And what makes this religion, our Christianity, different from any other that is out there, the reason we go to church on Sunday and not Saturday, what makes us so special is the fact that not the belief, but the fact that Jesus is alive.
Yes.
He's alive, and he's ascended back to the Father, where he now sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding on our behalf.
Yes.
Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone.
Yes.
And now I know. Do you know? I know who holds my future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
Come on, man.
Sin required a blood sacrifice, and Jesus was the perfect sacrifice for our sins.
Yes.
When he died on that cross, he said, it is finished. The curtain in the temple was torn from the top to the bottom, giving us direct access to God. You don't need the priest to go to God on our behalf anymore. You can now pray for yourself. And if you've never prayed the prayer of salvation, today is a good day.
Good day.
Let us stand in the doors of the church, are open.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's Resurrection Sunday morning.